Shh, don't say anything.
Well, we were going to do an episode on silence. I literally wasn't going to... Oh, forget about it. Who could be silent these days? Welcome to What We're Dealing With. I'm Greg Willits.
Wouldn't it be really funny if we literally just, like, people... At the end of the music, there was just, like, silence for 30 minutes.
I seriously thought about it.
That'd be really funny.
I'm Greg Willits from Adventures in Imperfect Living podcast at gregandjennifer.com.
I'm Jennifer Willits, his wife.
I'm Catherine Barron of the Catholic in a Small Town podcast.
And I'm Charlie Kaufman.
And this is What We're Dealing With. Charlie Kaufman?
I know. It was supposed to be Andy Kaufman. Because that was... But I screwed that up, right?
I'm not even sure who Charlie Kaufman is.
Charlie Kaufman is the writer. The writer of such things as Being John Malkovich and Schenectady.
Oh, and the Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, all that kind of stuff.
And anyway, that would be a very Charlie Kaufman, I mean, an Andy Kaufman thing to do, right, is to put out a podcast that was completely silent about silence. Yes.
And that's what we're dealing with. So Robert Cardinal Seurat wrote a book called The Power of Silence, Against the Dictatorship of Noise. And the biggest takeaway from this book...
Yes.
Isn't that nice?
Just for a second. Yeah, it really is.
I mean, just... We're basically doing what people have been wanting us to do for 15 years. Mac.
Just shut up.
Jennifer, Catherine, Greg. Shut up.
Just listen.
All right, so we ended our last show with the idea that the world is full of too much chatter because of the ease of technology. It allows us... to sort of not have enough self-control, that we curate these personas. What was the phrase we loved?
Curated imperfection.
And your persona becomes your prison.
Yeah. And the fact that everybody's doing it, so there's lots of chatter. And that naturally
lends us
to start talking about, okay, well, the opposite of that is silence. And Cardinal Seurat has written this book.
By the way, I actually had an opportunity to have a discussion just this week with Lisa Wheeler, who runs Carmel Communications, and they're the organization that does a lot of the promotion for Ignatius Press and others. And they're in the midst of promoting the new book, which we talked about several weeks ago, The Day Is Far Spent.
The
Day Is Now Far Spent, which I'm sure we'll talk about that in a few weeks when we all have a chance to finish that. Because I started reading that. Jennifer said, wait a minute, stop, read the silence book first. The Day Is Now Far Spent, such a good book.
You guys got to slow down. I can't.
Well, the silence, reading the silence book is super important. But I asked Lisa, I was like, okay, so we've been talking about Cardinal Seurat. Will you please set the record straight for us once and for all? Is it Sarah or Seurat? And she said, in the United States, everyone says Seurat. When you go over to Rome, they all say Sarah. So
really?
You pretty much can say it however you want at this point. So
it's more fancy if you go Seurat.
Well,
so that's why Americans, I think, default to that.
Apparently, Ignatius Press in the United States, they prefer for us to say Seurat, because that's like the common way of saying it in the United States.
Well,
but
so we shall.
Huzzah.
Huzzah to Seurat. We're not... finished with the book, and yet we felt like it very much applies to what we are dealing with in regards to the chatter that we talked about in the last episode, of the value that we personally bring to the work that we do through podcasting and online media, which we've done for many years, and then even evaluating what Catholics as a whole are doing online, and is there value in it? And even beyond that, I think it ties somewhat to what, Mac, you and I have been doing with this Exodus 90 program for the last several weeks, which calls us to greater asceticism, a holy hour, fraternity, and it has not been an easy spiritual exercise
because,
to go through.
Because a critical component of that holy hour is contemplative prayer.
Which we talked about a couple episodes back on the podcast. And how do you do that contemplative prayer in a world full of noise? And so just like with the newest book by Cardinal Seurat, The Day Is Now Far Spent, this is another book, The Power of Silence Against the Dictatorship of Noise, which I am in a state of perpetually underlining things.
And you too, huh?
It's like basically you're just, can I just underline the whole book? Is that possible?
And I love such conflict in today's day and age with ebooks. I love ebooks. The convenience it gives me, I can read an ebook on the treadmill. I can read an ebook early in the morning before my wife wakes up without having to turn on a light and bother her. And I can highlight in an ebook. But you want a paper book so that you could scribble notes all over the place and more than just underline, but write stuff in the margins and really, you know, exclamation points and everything. And this is another one of those books where I have highlighted. I'm a very short ways into it. I already have, according to Amazon, I have 18 highlights already that I've put into this book, which is quite.
And you're still in chapter one.
Yeah, I'm still on the table of contents. But just the idea of, for even before the desert, the solitude and the silence, God is already in man. The true desert is within us, in our soul. Statements like that go through this book, left and right.
That's kind of cliche sounding. God is in you.
No. But it's so much more. The true desert is within us, in our soul. What this book does, better than anything else so far, in the first 20 pages or however far, is it is the antidote to the railing that I think many of us have in our prayers, which is, I go to pray to God and I never hear him. And it is this, it's sort of, this is what my thought the other day. I'm a cradle Catholic, but I could never really give you a good reason why I'm Catholic. And it wasn't until my mid-20s that I really started questioning, well, what is it that I believe? And maybe I don't even have to be Catholic. Maybe I can go somewhere else. And I started looking at other faiths, and I started reading all sorts of books. And I used to go to a Christian bookstore, and if it had Jesus on the cover, I'd pick the book up and I'd read it, right? Even though I'm getting all sorts of conflicting ideas about things. And I just wanted to understand Jesus. I just wanted to know Jesus. I just assumed that no matter where I went, people would be telling me the truth. And yet I kept reading these books that just said, if you just have the right attitude, if you just have the right mindset, if you just think the right way, if you just have enough faith that things will be so much better for you. It's a like prosperity gospel in a way, but it was sort of like, it wasn't necessarily financial prosperity.
It's like a faith and fulfillment. Like if you just believe.
You claim it.
Yes.
I claim my happiness and therefore I will be happy. And it's not necessarily even just filling up your wallet, but it's just having that. And
it's the prayer of Jabez.
Exactly. It's like, you know, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory. Praise Jesus. But it wasn't until I started reading what the Catholic Church teaches in regards to suffering, which was, no. You will hurt, but your hurt, your suffering can have tremendous meaning. And suddenly it was like, whew, okay, then let me understand
suffering. What a relief.
What a relief, right?
What a relief as a human being. The Catholic teaching on suffering. Okay, I know this is not what this is supposed to be about.
No, it is. It's totally what it is.
But like the relief, because I mean, I had a mother who went through cancer, and she went to this like faith. She wasn't a faith healer, but it was like a counselor kind of healer thing. And it was, you would go and you would like take all the scriptures that dealt with faith and how if you just, you know, you name it and claim it, like God says that I'm supposed to believe in faith that it will happen, and it will happen.
Yeah.
Instead of feeling like this suffering is coming to me and there's going to be fruits that's going to come from the suffering, you see the suffering as a sign that you just don't believe hard enough.
Right. You're doing something wrong.
You're doing something wrong. If you just believed hard enough, you would be well.
So to companion with that, how many years have I spent going to adoration, spending time trying to be in silence and saying, God, I need to hear from you. I need to hear you. Speak to me, Lord. Here I am, Lord. I've come to do your will. And reading this book, that's fine. God is speaking to you, but he is speaking to you in silence. And the silence is actually where God does his work. And suddenly this idea of...
Mind blown.
Well, think about at the moment of conception. You don't hear the egg and the sperm uniting and a soul coming to existence. It sounds like this. You don't hear when an acorn finds or sprouts and takes root, it sounds like this. The greatest things that God does, he does it in silence.
You don't hear the moment that bread and wine become body and blood.
One of the greatest things that he wrote about in here, and again, a few episodes back, we talked about baptism. And I wish I'd read this book before.
I know what you're talking about.
He wrote in here, and Mac, have you had a chance to dive into this yet? Or is this, no. This is all sort of kind of new to you. So that, which is good that we have a representative who hasn't read this. So you could kind of push back on some of the things that we're asking. But he gave this illustration of baptism. When a person is baptized, they are baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and they have water poured on their heads. What happens at baptism is, according to Cardinal Seurat, is that you are not baptized with the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. You are taken as a person, and you are inserted into the Trinity. Now think about the water. You're being inserted into the water. You're being baptized in the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. You are inserted into that Trinity and into a relationship with the Trinity. You are inserted into that relationship. And when you are brought out, you are a new creature.
And that's...
From an outsider's perspective, that seems like an overly complicated metaphor.
I thought it was a beautiful metaphor. Why is it overly complicated to you?
Are you being serious, or are you just being funny?
To me, I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying, like,
it made so much sense. Because otherwise, again, this is what we were trying to get to a few weeks ago when we were talking about baptism. Otherwise, baptism is just this thing that we do. It's just this thing. And yet, and what happens in that moment, right? That is a perfect example of God silently in that moment transforms our very character. We become sons and daughters of God. This transformation occurs that there is no dun, 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 dun. We're not hearing
Ode to joy
suddenly. We are inserted into this relationship with the Trinity, and we are transformed. And all these things that happen in silence, well, then take that and put it, converse it with the world. Converse it? That's the wrong. Flip it around with the way that the world is, which is this noise, this constant interruption, this constant quest of the world to make us avoid silence. Silence isn't just quiet. Silence isn't just, you know...
The absence of noise.
The absence of noise. So, for example, the other morning, Jennifer, you were just a few pages into this book.
Right.
And I was still reading the other book, so I wasn't reading this book yet. And
I can't shut up. I'm, like, literally reading every thought out loud. Yeah. Greg, you got to hear this. Greg,
oh, this
you got to hear
this.
Oh, this
book on silence is one of the most amazing things I've ever heard in my entire life. Let me tell you, when we're thinking about silence, we got to really think about silence. No, but what you did something else, which is I find... the ability to be silent, I actually think about when I go and sit in front of the ocean and you're hearing noise of the waves, and yet how easy is it to go interiorly and to go very silent? For me, we actually have an air filter machine in our room that makes this white noise that brings me such peace and relaxation that the absence of that noise isn't silence to me. That makes more noise.
It's loud.
The quiet screams at me. And so what's funny is the other morning, you're like, oh, I'm reading this book about silence. We need silence. Click, you turn that thing off. And I was sitting there in bed, and I'm like, I can't think about anything right now. And it was tumultuous for me almost. How often, though, do we bring things into our lives that just make useless noise? That just, we have to have the radio on. We have to have the TV on in the background.
How many of us know, and I don't know why this is like a thing growing up, like people who never turn their television off. Mac. Not you, not Mac.
Yeah, I was about to say, that
not
didn't
you.
Sound right. I know what you meant. But yeah.
You know people that we know. Yeah.
Yep.
That, well, literally, even when people when people would be around having a conversation, and you would like, in. Oh, can I just, I'm just going to, this is commercial, can I just mute the TV? And they would lose their freaking minds.
All right. So when we had our first kid, I know my mother-in-law is never going to listen to this podcast, so I can say this. When we had our first kid, we had a small little apartment. We said, can you come up and help us for a few days with our son, Sam? So she came up. And we have a small baby in the house. We're just trying to, you know, trying to find peace and try to keep it nice and calm. Her mom would turn on the TV and I would come in the room and no one would be in there. So I turn the TV off and I leave the room and I go check on something. I come back into the room again and no one's in there, but the TV's back on. I'm like, what the heck? Who keeps turning on the TV? Turn off the TV again. I'd leave that. Every time I came in the room, the TV was on and no one would be in the room. But her mom kept coming in and turning the television on just because the need to have it on, the need for that noise.
Well, in this book, The Power of Silence, written by Cardinal Seurat, he says, without noise, man is feverish and lost. Noise gives him security like a drug on which he has become dependent. Greg. And the click word.
No, but see, I disagree.
That's shorthand.
That's what we call the air filter.
Yeah, I disagree. That sounds like 1984 double talk, doesn't it? Like,
click word.
The click word.
You know, I've been calling it click word for you. Click.
Not 1984. Word. Brave New World.
But see, you are making an erroneous distinction between noise and sound.
Well, white noise is noise, but you want it
to be something that it's not. You're trying to claim that it is distractive noise, whereas I'm saying this is something that allows me to go into a deep silence of prayer.
And yet from an outsider, I would say this is problematic because this is a subjective perception of sound waves passing through the air. So to someone else, the prattle of the morning coffee show, right, does the same thing that the white noise machine does for Greg. But the person like myself, when the white noise machine is going, it sounds like my neighbor's air conditioner when I'm on the front porch and trying to be with God.
Yeah, it's
and
shit.
The air conditioner cranks on and it's just going
and that air conditioner should just be like a white noise machine.
But it's not.
So
it's a subjective perception.
Yeah, it's just a matter of fright.
You, Greg, you love that. I don't.
Yeah.
Catherine and I love it when the power goes out and you can't even hear a refrigerator hum in the background.
And I lean a little bit more that way, but I completely understand what it does for you, that it's like an ocean.
This is why old people sleep in separate bedrooms.
Oh, no. Here's what we're dealing with. But for some reason, the sound of the waves in the ocean does not have that effect on
me. It is despite... the subjective nature of what you're talking about.
Because an ocean is natural.
Right.
That is a natural noise. Yeah. That is not something
God made.
That is not a machine. It is, it's part of the silence that...
I get the concept of it.
Yeah.
Especially if you equate it with something like the ocean.
That's okay. If all of you are telling me that I'm praying wrong and my relationship with God is a fraud because I pray best when I'm next to that machine... I'll have to agree with you because it's 3-1. So
I'm glad.
Obviously, I'll go to hell because I like to pray more.
But there's something wonderful, and I think using the ocean is a much better example, or is a much more relatable example than a white noise machine, because one, the ocean is natural, and we as Christians need to understand that God created the world, right? It is this enormous. For us Christians, it is this enormous example of, it is a metaphor of God, something so, it's bigger than we can imagine. Like there's so much ocean out there, we can't wrap our heads around it. And it's the constant noise of it, just the whoosh, whoosh. You know,
so
and it's
calming.
And it's so roundy. You know, there's no sharp edges to that noise.
Yeah.
Even when it crashes upon rocks, it's still roundy, it's wonderful.
Yeah.
Okay, Google, turn on click whir.
Sure, turning click whir on.
That's my noise machine in the studio.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong.
I don't understand.
Okay, Google, turn off click whir.
Sure, turning off click whir.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but what a white noise machine does is it mutes the other noises.
It does.
What a white noise machine does is take all the outside loud banging machine.
Yes. The things that distract.
Yes.
The noise.
Interrupt.
And the other noise.
The other noise.
And it balances it out.
That is awesome.
And that's what it does. So we have children. We have our bedroom is right next to the kitchen. So inevitably there's going to be clanging. A dish goes into the sink too loud, whatever. Right. And I'm highly sensitive to that. And it takes me away from my deep silence that I'm seeking with God.
Yeah.
And so this is something that allows me to focus on what it is God wants me to focus on.
And there is a difference, I think, between the noise of a home, which is very manufactured, and when we take ourselves, say, into the woods and sit.
Yeah, when Mac was giving the example of sitting on the porch and the air conditioning goes on at your neighbor's house, I totally agree. Because I would much rather hear crickets and the sound of nature outside I'm outside.
Yeah.
But when you're inside, again, how are you going to get that calmness? It's like, if I go into a church, I want there to be silence. I don't even want to hear music. I want silence.
Yes. So now I do think we've kind of gotten away from, if you listened to last week's episode.
It's because you're all trying to make me feel bad because I listened to the click word.
What we were trying to get to is the noise of our current environment. In not like in our homes, but the environment that we bring into our homes in our iPods, our iPhones, our Androids, our Google Home devices, our television sets.
You're almost making the point that it's not as much about the sound as it is about addiction to distraction.
Yes. The noise of our modern society. We see in our children, I think, the worst of that addiction where they literally cannot be without headphones in their ears, their phone running, and I admit to finding myself, I will head in that direction as well. And I'm an adult, hopefully, having a well-formed conscience, and I have this ability to blink and go, oh my gosh, this is terrible if I go through a week of that, right? And try to pull myself back from it. Our children don't seem to have that stopgap.
So Cardinal Seurat's book brought this to the forefront for us, as well as like the topic we talked about last week with Amy Wellborn's article about just this continuous noise on the internet of Catholicism. But Catherine, I think where you're going is actually a question that you posed to all of us in our own personal group chat, which is, how do we make our homes into small monasteries? How do we bring a prayerfulness and a silence into our homes that we, over the years, have bit by bit made factories of noise?
We filled with Amazon Echoes and Alexas's. And
I just called out Google a minute ago to do something for me that I could have easily done had I just bent over
and pushed
in my
button.
Chair and pushed a button. So then the question, you know, you said sometimes you love when the electricity goes out. Sometimes we go, oh man, I almost wish that there would be an electric magnetic pulse and everything would go out and we just had chaos.
It'd be great for like 24 hours.
Yeah.
And then we would all lose our minds.
And we'd lose our minds when we realized that, you know, the only thing that we can eat is what's growing in our yard.
Which is nothing because it hasn't rained here.
But I think this is a deeper subject that can really resonate with people. What can we do realistically, and how might we go about making our homes into places of greater prayer?
I have two ideas right up front.
Okay. Let me throw one thing out that Catherine and I actually shared.
I don't care. Mine.
Right before we started recording, which was part of what we might want to consider is, rather than our temptation is just go, I want everything to be holy in this house, and therefore we're going to banish televisions and the internet, and we're going to get
rid
of everything.
There will be no more Wi-Fi. If you want Wi-Fi, go to McDonald's.
Yeah, and where we just banish everything, it's almost like we need to take a note out of the devil's playbook and do it almost imperceptibly and in small increments time and chip away at it.
At the noise.
Until it's gone. Just like what the devil does a lot of times with people's own virtue is he just kind of chips away imperceptibly until someone has just become captive.
Chip away at the noise?
You've started doing it. Just recently, you said on Wednesdays?
Oh, yeah.
On Wednesdays, we're going to just go tech-free.
Greg, that was one of mine. Dang.
So you said Wednesdays,
I'm down to one now.
in your house, we're going to go tech-free. And so you do that for a while.
Now you've done it once. How'd it go?
Well, it didn't go well because we had friends come in that night. We left our kids by themselves.
It was not a typical day.
It was not a typical
Wednesday.
But
you tried to go for 24 hours. What if you said we're going to do a 6-hour fast?
Yeah.
What if we do it from when you get home from school until after dinner, and then we'll have 2 hours until you go to bed.
Until you go to bed.
And so let's have a four-hour fast and let people know in advance. We're just going to go 4 hours of silent. And then suddenly it's like it's more realistic because we tried to do tech-free Sunday, and it was great for a few hours until it wasn't.
Yeah. And you know, speaking of that, we also, that was part of our conversation, which is how Catherine actually came up with Wednesday. And it was because Sunday, it's not a true, it sounds at first like a fantastic idea until you start seeing Sunday as a celebration of Christ's resurrection. And it is a feast day.
And Christ resurrects and the Wi-Fi shall as well.
And everybody went to the movies, yeah. You know? So it takes away some of the joy of Sunday by imposing like blinders on the world on Sunday.
Yeah.
And that's that seems disingenuous if you think about it for more than 5 minutes.
No, I totally get it.
So then we came up with, okay, well, traditionally feast days or fast days are Wednesday and Fridays.
Well, it has been Fridays, but since you guys have been doing Exodus 90, Wednesdays are also a fast day. So we're like, well, okay, well, we're fasting from other things on Wednesday. Why not make this a part of that fast? Mm-hmm. So it felt, and you were already going to be trying to go to Mass on mm-hmm. Wednesday evenings. And so, well, if we can, I mean, what if that
that gobbles up another hour that I would have been on my phone.
Exactly.
So
and the win. And the boys are at school.
Mass. It gobbles up your hours.
Well, the boys are at school, so they don't
45 minutes.
They don't feel that imposition when they spend 7 hours of that day
on a weekend.
On a weekend it would feel like a bigger deal, but on a Wednesday. And so for your kids, for our kids, what we most want to do is show them you can do this.
Yeah, self-control.
You're not going to die.
And that's a virtue, right? Discipline. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, man. It's rough. Like, in our, none of us have what I would call demonstrative children.
No.
You know, when we talk about our kids losing their mind, it's, they've gone, what? But, oh, man, really? Like, that's okay. Them losing their mind. Like,
well, man. We have one son that will follow us around and sigh heavily every 5 minutes. And I'm kind of not joking.
We know.
That he will follow, he will just sort of stand hovering in nearby corners going,
so I guess I'll go lay down or something.
Yeah,
I don't know what to do.
I'll just
myself.
Sleep until the Wi-Fi comes back.
And this is a condition with our youth today. I
think
you're
right. I don't think it's just your son
that we gave them.
That we do enable them.
We pay for the phones. Right. We pay for the internet. We pay for the computers and everything else. We pay for it.
And
now we're paying the price.
Just like they're afraid to face the unknown of what do I do with myself, we're afraid to face them when they're facing the unknown because it makes parenting too hard.
And that was something I said to Catherine before we started recording is that we are more afraid of facing our children and turning off some of these devices than we are of letting our children go to hell.
Because, yes. Woo. But all the way.
Because if we were really afraid of our children losing their very souls, we would be more forthright in stopping some of the things that
they're actually allowing to come into their into their homes. And the other problem is as parents, now if you're a single person out there, you're like, oh, this is a great idea. It'll be silent in my house. I'm going to turn off the Wi-Fi and the TV. If you're a parent, the opposite is true.
It becomes loud.
It becomes loud. When the devices get turned off, because all of a sudden those kids that have been in their various corners of the home
giving you the silence that you want,
with their headphones on, what you want to do is do your own Wi-Fi fast, but let them have as much Wi-Fi as they want, because then you get your silence, and they stay plugged in.
Well, the way to counteract that is you turn off the Wi-Fi, and then when they come and say, "I don't know what to do," it's like, "Well, let's pray a rosary." They go away.
They'll find something else to do with themselves.
They'll be like, "Man, you know what? I'm good. That's fine."
But okay, so there's one thing you can do to make a little mini monastery in your home is enact a fast of noise, Wi-Fi, whatever.
Mm-hmm. Well, and make it be a complete fast. No music. This is not podcast time. This is not music time. This is quiet time, like genuine, honest. Now, people can make noise. People can talk to one another, but I'm saying...
Yeah, or can you play a family board game?
Yes, of course.
Time?
Yeah. I'm saying like outside noise being imposed upon the family.
And that's why I'm saying start it a few hours.
Yes.
So that you can also have some wins.
Yeah.
And you could say, wasn't that nice?
Yeah.
And your kids, you know, I think that we've had times where our kids were like, yeah, that was, it was actually better than I thought it was going to be. Yeah. So thanks for that, you know. And
I like the distinction you just touched on, the notion of the noise that comes from within a family unit and the noise of the world, the exterior noise that we allow to flood in continuously into our house. So really, this is a suggestion to close, the shut the gates down on the outside noise that's coming into your home. And it's okay if the kids are, you know, being loud and rambunctious or, you know, giving each other a hard time or arguing or playing. That's a natural noise to the yes. season of life that you are in.
That's
as long
life,
as they do it outside.
Okay.
Just outside.
It's almost like the never-ending waves of the ocean with our family.
The gnashing and
that
waves.
That makes you want to put a gun in your mouth.
So what was
that? Mac.
Pretty terrible.
And hyperbole.
Mac is what we're dealing with. What's the other thing you were going to say?
I was going to ask that same thing. What was the other thing?
To make a holy place. To make a place that's set aside.
Inside your home.
Inside your home. Just a little corner that has a kneeler or that has some icons or that has some candles that you can go and light.
So
that doesn't have a screen in it.
I think that sounds nice. I worry that that's just going to become another spot to dust. You know, at first you set those kinds of things up because I read about home altars and I love the idea, but you set it up. How do you use that? How do you go? I mean, what, how, and so I'm not saying that it's wrong. I'm just saying I'm trying to understand how do you do that? Because I think that there's an even more difficult conversation that goes back to the sort of the chipping away at things. So we used to be somewhat proud. I don't think in a bad way. Proud of the fact, and I think you felt the same way, that we, for many years, were a one television home.
Yes.
We had one television. We had it in our living room, and that's where it was. And therefore, there was never anything on the televisions that was inappropriate. And it was able to be limited. And because it was in the center of the home, when other things were going on, we turned it off. And we even had doors that we could shut so that we didn't have to look at it all the time. And then somewhere along the lines, you know, one TV got, this is how it started. Again, I'm just convinced the devil's nefarious. We had a TV and just quit working. It's like, oh, okay, well, we got to go get another TV. And then we found out after we got the other TV, it's like, oh, that's all had to happen to fix the other TV. So we brought it to someone and for like $30, they fixed the TV. So suddenly we had two TVs.
Two televisions.
And then we moved somewhere else and we had a little nook that's like, this would be a good place for a TV. But the other TVs are being used now in other places, so we need to get a third TV. And now we're in a smaller house, and now I'm sitting there going, why do we have three TVs? How did this happen? Why
do we have four game consoles?
Why do we have this? And so I actually have been sitting there, and it's amazing how difficult it is to even consider, should we get rid of some of these TVs?
How much money did we spend on that TV? Because of the excellent graphics and the 4K.
I'm not saying we get rid of that TV. I'm saying we get rid of the crappy one.
Keep the good one.
No, but I mean, like we now, so then I find the conflict of, it's nice to be able to go in our room and watch TV because the other kids are, they're doing something. Or we want, you know, if we go watch TV in the main room, then it's longer for the kids to go to bed. And, you know, there's always a reason that you just need that one extra TV.
Right.
Now, of course, this is not counting
the
any tablets or phones that may be able to get the exact same stinking content.
Or desktops, or whatever. That's
what happened to us in our family because we just had the one television and then we got a computer.
Sorry.
And then that computer was plugged into the internet. And those of you that are listening that remember this happening eventually, and then Hulu came out. And it was like all of a sudden now I don't have cable on my television because I'm better than that.
And do you remember Hulu's earliest ad campaigns?
No.
Do you remember Alec
Baldwin?
It was like
aliens taking over, right?
Hulu is here to take over the world.
And streaming services have done that. And so I think, started out our married lives, we're raising the banner of we're not going to be those people. We are those people. We are those people times 10.
We are now the banner children of the, you know.
Yeah,
for that.
We are.
So then, chipping away.
Get rid of one TV.
Imagine if you created a 12-month plan for minimizing technology in your home. that you don't share this with your children, by the way.
Yeah. It's a secret plan.
You just...
It's like the fourth secret of Fatima.
You start introducing fasting. You start introducing hours of fasting. And then you say, you know what? We need the money. So we're going to sell that television. And you sell the television. And we're going to take that money. And you know what? Rather, since it's that console is just sitting there not getting used, let's go ahead and sell that. We'll use that to buy something nice at Christmas for the family.
Yeah.
That doesn't include electronics, right? And then you just start minimizing things.
A humidor.
When it comes to, but what about things like phones and that kind of thing? So we had the best of intentions when we moved into this new house back in February of this year. Now it's almost October. That everyone would take their phones and plug them in the kitchen when they go to bed at night. And that lasted for 24 hours, maybe?
Let me tell you what. You can do it, though, man. You can do it. Last night, did I want to hear my son him and haw when I went to bed at 10 o'clock and he was going to be up for another 2 hours? And yet, I listened to him and haw for a second, and I finally said, I really appreciate you doing this for me. Thank you.
Wait a minute.
And he plugged it up.
Ben Barron.
Where does he plug it up?
He plugs it up right outside our door.
So outside your door, not inside your door. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Why did you choose that? Why not in your room?
Because oftentimes...
I look to my wife. Help me.
because we go to bed before they do. And so sometimes we go to bed before they do, especially Mac.
But you just said you had him in hall last night. You asked him to plug it in earlier.
Last night he did, but up to now...
Catherine was not home. I was the only adult home.
Yeah.
I went to bed and said, Ben, I'm going to bed.
But in the past, we said, please just plug up your phone before you go to bed. It's like on the honor system, basically. Mm-hmm. Like, we'll say, if the phone's not plugged in outside my room when Daddy gets up in the morning, and Daddy always gets up before everybody else, then there will be consequences or whatever. But I just want to chime in and say...
Were the phones plugged up when you came home?
Yeah. No. That's not what I was going to chime in to say. I was going to chime in to say, I'm like the worst. Because, like, I get home from work at 12:30. Everybody else is asleep. I want to wind down. And the house is quiet. I don't want to make noise. So I'm going to watch. I want to watch something on my phone. And I just do it and fall asleep to it. And it's terrible.
That's awful for you.
And I'm tired. And I should just go to bed or read something until, you know, if you start reading something, 3 minutes are going to go by. And you're going to be like, oh, yes, 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 and you're going to fall asleep. And so, I mean, I just want to chime in. And just say, we're talking about our kids, but I chief among sinners here, you know? What are we so afraid of?
This is really speaking to a fear that we have got to start looking at. Should be afraid of hell more than anything.
Yeah. But
blah, Jennifer. Hell. Sorry.
I'm not saying
you sound like me when I'm falling asleep at night. Blah, 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 honey. Hell.
I'm not saying you're wrong, but when you go in to have an appendectomy, you don't want the doctor to start looking at your feet, right? So that's my Dr. Phil way of saying, let's stop muddying the waters. Let's look at one thing at a time. Right. What Catherine's talking about, I don't think is a fear. That's not a fear of being alone with herself, thoughts before she goes to bed. That is a feeling like the world owes you some downtime. And my downtime is to unplug my brain and plug it into this dumb reality show or Hoarders or whatever. You know,
that was just this week.
Fixer Upper.
Hoarders was just this week.
But seriously.
But what should we do?
But yeah, I mean,
you should instead read a book. You should try to do an exam.
So wait a second. Can I call you out for just a second?
Sure.
Okay. So I will say this. So Mac does not have a problem with his phone at night. He literally can plug it up next to his bed. He's not going to mess with it. It's fine. So because I've said in the past, why don't we just make a thing where we all plug our phones up downstairs? Then it's something we're doing together as a family. Mm-hmm. Like, here's the thing. And Mac goes, yeah, but I don't have a problem with my phone. So I'm going to plug mine up by my bed. And so I would say, as someone who A, doesn't have a problem with it, and B is like, you know, sort of supposed to be making an example, it might be good if you say, I'm going to plug my phone up downstairs. I would like everyone to join me.
That's fine.
Does that make sense?
Sure.
Because correct
that's
me
how Catherine got what she wanted.
But no. But correct
she
me.
Asked
if,
a podcast.
But correct me if I'm wrong in that you like.
I would like before the audience makes an assumption. This might be the second time we've talked about
this.
That,
yeah.
That
this
thing.
Is not like
this
a thing.
This is not
that
like Catherine
up.
Going, now Mac. It's just, no, this no, no, is, no. This is really the second time she's ever mentioned it.
I'm just thinking about this because I'm like, how do we as parents lead the way? How do we as parents lead the way? Because I'm sitting here going, you know, I get on to my son for falling asleep at night because he ought to be going to bed. He's got to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning.
Wait, what? You get on to him for falling asleep at night?
Watching his phone.
Okay.
But I do stay awake.
I get on to my child for falling asleep at night.
But I do.
Childhood in our house is much like SEAL training.
But I do the same thing. I am just as guilty. But I don't have a place where I go plug my phone up downstairs, so it's not a temptation for me. So I guess I'm calling on the person who doesn't really have an issue with it.
To be the bad guy?
To be a leader.
To be the leader.
You buy me an alarm clock. And I'll do that.
I literally have an alarm clock that was yours on my side of the bed. It's true. I mean, I'm just saying. Cool. I don't.
Can I have that?
Yes,
back?
You may. Yeah, you can. But
this has suddenly turned into a private conversation.
I guess my point is that we as parents, I mean, you want to say, how do we create monasteries? Well, it has to start with us. You know, we do the best by leading by example, by looking at our own lives. You know, how many of us have heard the story of the dad who will yell at his kids for cussing or yell at his kids for this or yell at his kids for that? And he does that thing. He's, you know, don't smoke, don't drink. But dad smokes every day. You know, we as Christians evangelize by example. We talked about this after the, when the Marriage Equality Act came out, you know, when the Supreme Court made marriage legal in the whole United States or between same-sex couples. I think the conversation that we had on our podcast was, how do we combat this? And I say by being the best couples that we can be, but we lead by example. We show that in our Christian marriages, we can love one another. We can put one another first, because the divorce rate among Christians is the exact same as the divorce rate among secular people. So in the same way with this noise issue, right, we have to lead by example.
And to bring it back around to the book written by Cardinal Seurat about the importance of silence and how we need to relearn how to be silent so that we can hear God, who is already there, who is silence. And so if we have too much noise in our households, it's going to be a struggle to get to this place of silence, which we see as a worthy goal. Because God is there. And so there is much work to be done.
Well,
much work to be
and
done.
And I think what you said earlier, Jennifer, about the health thing, if you want to kind of bring it to that, by teaching our children how to live with some silence in their lives, we are showing them the way to God. Like, if you can find some silence, if we can cultivate the silence, then God can enter into it in the silence of their own hearts. But if we allow the noise of the world to continually batter our children, then we have been culpable. We have, like Father Higgins said this morning, he said there, you know, why was the rich man in hell? He was in hell not because of anything he had done, but because of that he had not done. And if as parents...
Sin of omission.
Yes, as parents, if we do not at least make the effort to make silent places for our children to hear the voice of God, then we can be culpable in them losing their faith.
So that's the failure to do what we know we ought to do is the sin of omission. And we know what we should do, but if we're too afraid to do what we ought to do, that's on us.
That's right.
That's on us.
Well, that's what we've been dealing with. We would love to hear what you've been dealing with. How can they reach out to us, everybody?
You can go to feedback@catholicinasmalltown.com.
And if you want to say something to Greg and me at the same time. So we encourage you to use two email addresses for now.
That's
because
right.
Hopefully soon there'll be one email address to reach all four
I'm
of us.
I'm working on it.
But it is feedback@gregandjennifer.com. So please be sure to put both email addresses in your comments about what we have said. If you want to chime in on the conversation, add some more.
We would love to read it and be edified by your words of wisdom.
You can find more at whatweredealingwith.com and listen to past episodes. And we ask you to please, if you haven't already, make sure you're subscribing to the show, tell others about it, as well as leave your 5-star written reviews on iTunes and help others to discover the show. So that's it for now. I'm Greg Willits from Adventures in Imperfect Living at gregandjennifer.com.
I'm Jennifer Willits, his wife.
I'm Catherine Barron.
And I'm Mac Barron.
And this is What We're Dealing With.